think.
Hey now.
You love it, Robin. Hey now. You're not a big hey now person.
No,
Robin.
I very rarely say hey now.
I love it. I'm going to do it for about a minute now.
Okay.
Everybody get ready. Hey now.
Hey now.
Hey now.
Hey now.
Hey now. All right. Enough. I don't care. That's enough.
That wasn't even a minute.
I love hey now. I'm sure that everyone now has watched Game of Thrones.
I watched it. It was very tough for me.
It was tough for everyone. I mean, I won't give any spoilers out, but I think by now everyone knows that the episode is so dark.
From the start of the episode, it's pitch black. And I go, okay, it'll get better. It'll be 5 minutes, 10 minutes, 15 minutes. A full 82 minutes. I couldn't see anything.
You didn't know what was happening.
I don't know what happened. You didn't see one of those zombie dudes fighting. Like, you couldn't tell who was fighting
you
who.
You never saw an individual zombie dude.
I still don't even know what happened. That kid who sits in the wheelchair, I don't know what he was doing.
I had to go on these stupid websites with the nerdy people who actually slow it down and look frame by frame to find out what happened.
You don't have to call us nerdy people.
Okay.
And here's a weird thing. Everyone around here who works with us is complaining about the episode.
Uh-huh.
John Hein thinks it was like the greatest.
Oh,
and he's a weirdo. Like, he's the guy who started Jump the Shark. And I said, John, you know what? I used to think you were a really bright guy and a really...
He just jumped the shark.
A good critic. Like, he's in here defending it. You got to hear him. You want to hear John Hein defend this?
I want to hear how he defends this.
You have no idea what happened when you were watching it. You probably had to read
those blogs that I did.
Well, I read those anyway after the fact. But no, I liked the episode a lot.
How? But you couldn't see anything.
Okay, look, this fight was supposed to take place at night,
right,
in the north.
Yes.
With, you know, so I think what they tried to do, and I admit it was dark, but they tried to make you feel like
you were
part of the...
I don't need to be part of it.
But let me ask you something. Why?
Why would I not want to know who's getting killed?
When I saw the Helen Keller story on film, she's blind. I don't need to be blind.
They didn't give you Helen Keller's point of view.
No. Don't you want to see the zombie fight the other person? Don't you want to see what they look like?
We did.
You could see the zombies in that episode.
Look, I'm not going to spoil
anything. Did you see one zombie?
Yes. You saw more than one.
No, you saw maybe
five. You did not.
Okay.
You only saw the leader.
There was a really tall guy who came in, right?
That was the giant.
So that was
But you couldn't even see the battle.
That was a great scene.
You can't tell me that you weren't sitting there for the first hour scratching your head going, what the fuck are they doing?
I wasn't. I was caught up in it.
I was screaming at my TV.
In a movie you want to see. I was screaming too. Oh, come on, John.
You couldn't.
Why? You love that show so much you can't fucking get off this? You're a guy who had credibility with me. I see you in a whole different light.
Howard,
now.
I'm not saying it wasn't dark. I admit, I'm not saying it was pitch black. No, it wasn't.
Look at me with an honest look.
Okay.
You loved the episode.
Yes.
You loved it.
Yes.
One of your favorites.
I thought it was great.
That big woman that, whatever,
yes,
you know, who.
Brienne?
Yeah.
The one who was just made a knight?
Yeah.
Okay.
I don't know what happened.
Big giant woman.
All right.
I want to tell you what happened to her? I'll tell you how you know. You went on a blog.
No,
and
that's not true.
The same thing.
You see the big, tall, blonde
woman. He's a bullshit
woman.
Artist.
I'm not bullshitting.
Get out of here. You're out of your mind.
You see her fighting all
You've
these
You've lost bullshit, all credibility.
Bullshit, bullshit.
Gary, what do you make of this?
Oh, boy.
I mean, John and I were at odds yesterday. It's probably the biggest disagreement we've had.
Can you swallow your food and then talk to me?
Really.
I am. It's probably the biggest disagreement we've had since I've known him. And we were having the same argument. He's like, no, you're wrong. They're trying to recreate the confusion of war. I'm like, I don't want to be confused. I want to see the fucking war.
No, the confusion of war can be seen, but you got to be seeing it.
Yeah, there was plenty of confusion in Saving Private Ryan.
JD, do you agree with him?
I mean, I liked the episode. I thought it was a good episode.
Thank you, JD.
Well, what does that mean, JD?
You're a fucking
You like
idiot.
Dark episodes?
Do you really like that? I thought you hated
listen,
it.
No, I do admit it was dark, and some things were confusing, like when the dragons were flying around. But overall, I understood what was happening.
But you had to struggle to understand it. Why should you have to struggle? Why should it be a struggle? I wanted to see dragons. I wanted to see the army of the dead.
You did see the army of the dead.
I saw nothing.
That giant mass of zombies who came to...
It was just
you
black.
You couldn't see them.
It was black. Thank you, John, for your review.
You're welcome.
I'll respect you, but it's hard to.
Thank you, John.
Here's your
theme song. Hit them. Hit them with the Hein. Charlize, what is going on with romance? I want to know, because this is crazy.
You are the hottest woman on
oh
earth.
Oh, my God.
Every guy wants you. Every guy needs you.
That is not true, Howard.
No.
You don't even know where you are right now.
Because you're in the room. Yeah. I'm dizzy. Charlize.
You don't know what's going on right now.
What do you mean I don't know?
Because that is not true.
Are you dating?
I am dating, yes.
You are?
Yes.
Is anyone in your league, is there anyone acceptable
yes.
to you? You're
yes.
in love?
No, I'm not in love. No.
You're just dating?
Yes.
This is crazy.
Do you know
who? Do you know who she's dating?
No.
No, he doesn't.
She doesn't discuss.
She would not tell me.
Don't you think it's crazy?
That's not true.
That
I will tell you.
Is Charlize too particular?
I will tell you. I will tell you. I will tell you.
I don't think she's too particular.
No, I'm not.
Is she too particular?
No, I'm not.
What is going on? Because I feel Charlize should have found the great love of her life.
No, I want to be clear.
Go ahead. Make a statement.
Make a statement. Yeah, right.
Is everybody listening?
What happened to the high
I was
official.
Raising two small children,
right.
And your life just becomes very all-consuming, you know? They
True.
Need you for everything. And I'm a single mom.
No nannies?
I have one nanny.
Okay.
And so it's not like I have a ton of help, and I really, you know, I wanted to be a mom, so I was enjoying it. Now they're starting to do, like, my littlest one is, like, you know, taking care of herself. Like,
right.
My time is opening up a little bit more.
A little bit. So you're opening yourself up
yes,
emotionally to
yes.
perhaps being in the great
yes,
love of your
totally.
Life.
Totally. I mean, no pressure.
Are you easy to live with?
I'm sure I'm not. I'm not going to be like, I mean, I live a very, very simple life.
What do you mean by simple?
Meaning that I'm not a high maintenance person.
Like I would agree with
like,
that.
My
no
life
mansion,
is,
no big house.
I've lived in the same house for 25 years.
This is terrible.
I don't have like a bunch of homes.
Squalor.
I have one home.
One home.
I bought my mom a home.
Right.
We live a very, very, very simple life, and like I don't have a staff of people. I like doing shit for myself. Like,
who should Charlize be with, Seth? You're good at this. You're a good matchmaker.
When it's a tough one.
You've worked with this woman now. Long shot the movie. You spent months with her. You've become
yes.
friends, I assume.
Yeah.
Who can we set her up with that would be the right guy?
This is not the time and the place.
This is not
the time. This is the only place. Are you kidding?
I would never presume. I don't fucking know.
You don't know. You didn't set her up the whole time.
I would no. There's no one I set her up. I would never. But I do agree that you are very like. I would like. I don't think you're the problem.
That's
oh no,
a very
she,
nice thing
yeah.
to say.
There's no
that's
way
so
she's
nice.
The problem.
No, yeah.
Oh, that's
I know.
Very
believe
sweet.
Me, I'd overlook a lot sweet. Of nonsense.
Yeah.
I'll tell you that. JD went to his home, and I'm actually going to yell at him a bit. He's spending too much money when he went home. He was a big shot. He went to a Cincinnati Reds game, and he spent like $1,000, treated everyone to...
What are you talking
oh,
about?
Oh, yeah, big shot. How much did you drop on that game?
Yeah, it was over $1,000.
Why are you treating everyone? Who are you, Daddy Warbucks?
Well, no, it's something I wanted to do. I knew my dad's done it before, so I wanted it for me, so I wanted to do it for him.
Would you have to get the best seats?
Well, I mean, I like to try. Once you do this, like, it's nothing is great.
Once you do this, nothing is great?
I've sat in those seats before, and it was awesome, so I wanted to do it again.
Why you do this is right.
What's that, Fred, JD?
Why you do this?
Yeah.
You can't go back up to the rafters, huh?
We have beer and we have chili.
He went back home, took the wife, and I don't know, he bought like 4 or 5 tickets. Like, what are they? How much a ticket?
Like $240 or $260. 4 tickets.
And then what do they have, a buffet?
There's a buffet before the game. And
it's
then,
included with the $260?
Yeah. And then,
what's at the buffet?
Cheetos.
Yeah, they had like prime rib there. Just like a bunch of like some fish. It was okay. It was a decent buffet.
Could you identify the foods?
All I know is supposedly JD paid all this money, but he went in there and there was tons of riffraff, and he
riffraff.
Yeah, he had to stand online forever for this free food that he's supposed to get.
The only riffraff I saw was Atlanta Braves fans. I don't know what they were doing there, but. Yeah, there was a lot of people, and you had to wait in line forever. And then by the time I finished the plate, it was time for the game to start.
Does he have a way with the story or what?
Yes, he does. I could listen for hours.
J.D. Fred.
Atlanta. Kim Foster. Game Star.
He should get one of those shows where he just tells you a story every
and you try
evening.
To figure it out for
yes.
prizes.
Once upon a time, sometimes from Ohio.
Who is the greatest stand-up comic of all time?
Richard.
Pryor.
Yeah. We all just as princes.
Really?
But yeah, but Richard would say that Charlie Chaplin was the greatest of all time.
He I thought Eddie Murphy was better than Richard Pryor.
Well, that's your opinion. You know what I'm saying?
I'm allowed to say it.
Yeah, of course.
Well, it's America. You can't say anything you want.
Everyone's allowed. This is what I feel. Yeah. Everyone has a right to their own opinion. It's not like I'm right and you're wrong.
Right.
I value your opinion, just not more than mine.
Right. Right. No, listen, you're a stand-up.
Just not more than mine.
In this case, your opinion does matter.
Yeah, Richard is the king.
He's
We're
the gold
all just
standard.
His princes.
What the business of Tracy?
He probably asked Eddie. Eddie would say the same thing.
Yeah. Oh, of course he would.
Charlie did it when there wasn't no noise to make people laughing. You no
can't
noise?
Even say anything.
Come on, what?
Right.
Buster Keaton. Come on, man. We can't forget them. I got my physical from Carol Burnett and Lucille Ball.
Yes,
that's when comedy was comedy, when nobody was scared to take a fucking pie in the face. Lucille right. Ball stuffed chocolates in her mouth. Come on, man. You weren't worried about her image.
You're right.
You're about the comedy. You always, as a stand-up, as a funny person, you always keep the comedy first, man.
Got to tell the story. I don't even know if Charlize knows about this. But weed does get you in trouble occasionally. Didn't you finally like meet Steven Spielberg, who I guess is like, you know, the guy to meet?
Yeah.
And you were in the like smoking a joint in front of him?
Yes, I was.
Tell that story. Do you know about this, Charlize?
I do not.
Yeah.
What happened, Seth?
It's why it's probably why I'm not like in a lot of Steven Spielberg. talent is probably also, but I was at a party. Yeah. And it was
whose party? Was it a big party?
I think it was that Jeffrey Katzenberg night before party that he would have.
That's a big
so
deal.
It's like a big party with a lot of famous people at it. Mm-hmm. And I was outside and there was someone else I knew and we started smoking weed and I was smoking a joint and like it was this awkward moment where like Steven Spielberg came up to me like as I had this joint in my hand and I could just tell like he did not like it. Like it was a very right. judgmental moment. And then you're confronted with this thing where it's like, do I fucking try to hide it? Do I just keep smoking it? Do I act
it's like,
a, do
it's
I,
like your
what
dad
do I
caught
do?
You.
Exactly. And then I was just like, I think I just have to take ownership over this and keep smoking this joint in front of Steven Spielberg.
That is the
and
greatest.
I did. Yeah. And yes. And I've run into him a few times and he always seems a little disappointed in me.
So the
time.
Whole time you're talking to him,
yeah.
you said, that's it. I got to go.
I just got to fucking smoke this shit. I got to down this thing while face to face with Steven Spielberg.
I hear you got a permanent girlfriend now.
Permanent girlfriend.
Really?
Yeah.
Really? Look at you getting
locked
off
down.
The road. Yeah.
You were hitting it fucking crazy out there on the dating scene, huh? You finally settled down.
Yeah. I mean, this girl's so awesome that I was like, you know.
She must be super hot, right?
Super hot.
And you're not fucking anyone else.
Not fucking anybody else.
Wow.
Yeah.
How long did it take her to lock you down?
Yeah. Like, did you start dating her and then you were exclusive or you fucked, you know, other people and now you're settling down?
There was a bit of transition.
Yeah.
There was some overlap there.
Yeah.
Which she's not too happy about.
See, they think like women. So she's thinking, oh, he's dating me, so he's not fucking anyone else. That'd be gross.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
She's grossed out. We had a talk last week. She's very...
grossed out by that, right?
She's annoyed by it. But I'm like, you know, we were hanging out. We were drinking a little bit one night. And then she goes, hey, I got to ask you something. You know, you were on vacation a few months ago. And she's like, I looked at your Instagram and I saw there was some girl you were talking to and stuff.
Yeah.
And she's like, did you hook up? And I'm like, yeah.
Right. You were honest.
Yeah, I was honest. I was like, at least I'm honest about it.
Yeah.
And I was like, you know, we were an exclusive together. I didn't know where she was at and everything.
Right.
And,
yeah, but women generally think that like, and now I get it. Now I'm a little older and wiser. Like as guys, we really shouldn't, like if you're seeing someone and you are fucking, you probably should only be fucking them. Like playing like a whole, like good looking guys like you can get a lot of girls.
But you shouldn't do that. Like, you should only fuck one person at a time. I'm a big believer in that.
There were times where I'm hooking up with one girl and I'm like, oh, this girl's awesome. Maybe I should lock that down.
Right.
And then another opportunity comes up and I'm like, well, if I miss that opportunity.
Right. How do you know?
One in the bank.
Well, like you know, there was a girl that I was seeing before her. And then I'm like, well, what if I was like exclusive with that girl? And then I would have never met her, you know?
No kidding. I got to see a picture of this girl.
Like, I'm coming way too quick recently.
Because
she's too good. Her ass, and I'm just looking at her, and I'm like so into her that
it's
fucking my game up. You know, I used to be able to hold out forever.
Yeah.
And in recent days, it's not as easy.
Awesome. Wow.
Yeah, it's great.
Well,
you're the man.
I hope you're doing the job because they say that millennial women are having a lot more sex, but fewer orgasms.
Yeah. No. The work is being done.
Lucky they're not sleeping with me. So your girlfriend's ass is so nice, you come too quick.
Too quick, yep.
Wow. Good for you.
The whole ass thing, streaks. The cute face, her whole body is so hot. It's just fucking...
And like, she has a good personality.
Great. She is the
fucking
coolest. No.
Yeah.
Not at all. Like, we've just been spending so much time together. Like, she's just fun. And
you in love?
Yeah.
Oh, you're in love with her?
Yeah.
When did you fall in love?
About a month or two ago.
No kidding.
Yeah.
What do you love about
her? Did you say it?
She said it first, but I was going to say it that weekend.
Yeah.
And then we were drunk, and she kind of slipped it out, and then she went, ah, fuck. She's like, I thought you were going to say it.
You've been a victim of, almost a victim of the casting couch. You said at one point in your career, you were very, I don't know where you were at in your career, some producer invited you to his
house. It was my first audition ever.
Oh my God.
I had just turned 19. I might have still been 18. I had never been out for an audition. I asked this modeling agent if she heard of anything, like I was going to give this acting thing a try. She said, yep, go to this guy's house. It's on Saturday at 9.
Seth, all of your auditions are done at the house?
At my house on Saturdays at 9 in the morning. When you're a little foggy, you're a little, your guard is down.
It was 9 p.m.
Oh, my God.
Oh, even
we called a date. Yeah,
yeah, 9 p.m.
There should be a law against that, right? I mean, you would think your agent or somebody.
Well, I didn't have an agent.
But you think somebody would have thought.
I don't think she had a clue either. She was just like, I guess this is what they do.
And the guy's a big deal, and he's famous.
He was a very big deal and is still a big deal. Yeah.
So on a Saturday night at 9 o'clock, you go over to audition for a film.
Yeah.
And how does that play out? What happens?
I knocked on the door and he opened up the door and he was in his pajamas.
Hey.
Barefoot.
First of all, why do guys think they're gonna like why do guys think showing your dick to someone is gonna turn them on?
It's embarrassing when any guy thinks they're sexy at all. Even sexy guys should not act as though their physical being is in any way tempting.
That can't be a good look on any level.
And by the way, I just like want to clear, I mean, I don't know, Robin, do you agree? Like, we don't want to see you just pull out your dick.
No, that's exactly right.
So you go to the guy's house.
Yeah.
It's Saturday night, and I'm sure you're, and here he answers the door in the pajamas. Do you just like turn around and say, this guy?
I should have. I didn't.
Pajamas are not a good look on a man.
No. But he had a very healthy ego. He felt very good about himself. Ugh. There was some kind of muzak playing in the house.
Oh, God.
Indie music.
A lot of like
never good.
Cold marble and crystal. And then we sat down and we started talking. He sat very close to me. That was strange. The drinking bothered me. I was like, this doesn't feel right. I kept kind of saying, as he was asking me questions about me, I said, I've never done this. So just tell me, like, I have these pages. Do you want me to read these pages? And he was like, no. We're just going to talk.
Ugh.
And then at one point he put his hand on my knee.
Aye.
And that's when I just went, ooh. And it's crazy. And girls talk about this where you just go blank. Like, you don't know what to do. But I left. I don't even know how I got out of the house, but I left and I.
That's was amazing. That
driving my. Yeah, because it would have ended really badly. But I was driving my Ford Fiesta that I was renting, like up Laurel Canyon. And I was so angry with myself that I didn't say something. You know, I was like, why? I'm not that kind of girl. Like, why did I not tell him to go fuck himself? Like, it made me so angry.
You know why? Because in the moment, if you're a decent human being, even you can't believe what's happening to you.
Yeah.
And you feel like you should be polite.
Yeah.
It's weird. And then afterwards you go, why am I so fucking polite?
Yeah, exactly.
Why am I such a good boy or a good girl? Like
you're
why?
Like, can people get like murdered because they're polite? There's there's like books about how like most people would rather not be impolite and keep themselves out of mortal danger.
Right.
Than potentially like hurt someone else's feelings.
Yeah.
Which is crazy.
It took me 8 years for this thing to come full circle because he offered me a job.
Whoa.
Oh.
And I went purely just to have my moment where he said, nice to meet you. And I said, no, we've met before.
Whoa. Oh.
And he had no recollection of it. And his producing partner was standing right next to him and he was embarrassed.
Which, by the way, it shows you how many women he did it to. Mm-hmm. He doesn't even remember. Like, it was not a one-off.
That's insane.
That is insane. The amount, the numbers. So you mean literally he now you're famous.
Yeah, had no idea.
I want to get Charlize Theron in a movie.
Yeah.
You walk in and you finally said, no, you met me and here's what happened.
And I went down the list. I said it was at 9 p.m. on a Saturday at your house. You were wearing pajamas. Mm. I went down the list.
Oh, wow.
I had my moment.
What did he say?
He said, wow, I do not remember that.
I bet you he doesn't.
Yeah, right.
I don't remember that. Conveniently, I forgot. Oh, my God. I heard a very beautiful story about you.
What?
That you're a giving guy in the sense that Michael Che, who is now successful on Saturday Night Live, I heard, and tell me if it's true, and I love this if it is, that when he was doing stand-up, you pulled him aside, and you were already, you know, famous, obviously, and you were accomplished. And you said
he's a very smart, I love him, funny.
Smart, funny guy.
Mm-hmm.
But you pulled him aside in a club, and you said, look, I hope you don't mind, but I'm going to give you some advice here. You need to get away from the mic stand.
Yeah.
What does that mean, get away from? Why did you tell
him
that?
Take the mic out the mic stand and move it to the side because you got an environment there. Use your whole environment. You got to walk the stage. I don't give a fuck how big it is. You got pockets of love over here, an audience pockets. Never neglect no part of your audience in the back. You got to project so your voice is heard in the back.
Why do
That's
I have to do that?
That's why they call you stand up because you want them to see you.
I don't
like that leaning on the mic stand. That's a bad habit you pick up in the clubs. No. You ain't never seen Eddie Murphy used the whole stage.
Right.
Richard Pryor used the whole stage. I used the whole stage. All that environment, and you just standing there telling jokes? Nah. I don't tell jokes, man.
I tell stories.
I tell the truth on stage. That's why everybody laughs. Because you can identify and relate with it no matter who you are, where you're from. The truth is the truth. I wouldn't give a fuck if you live in Bangladesh. The truth is the truth.
Is comedy like music in the sense that, remember like Oasis? Oasis? They would just stand there and play. And it there was not a lot of stage presence. But when you see Mick Jagger running around and you see him on stage.
Come on, that's a show.
That's a show. So Michael Che was standing there.
I just told him you should move around more.
Well, you must have seen something.
But sometimes we get stuck in a box.
Did he take offense?
We get conditioned to know. He loved me. I love Che.
Right.
We get, because I started off that way. Mm-hmm. And then I had someone like Jimmy Mack give me advice.
Right.
So I just passed it on. That's knowledge. Knowledge is like love. You can't do nothing with it but pass it on. So I just passed it on to somebody I thought was worthy. And he worthy.
So some friends tell you about something called ayahuasca in Peru.
Yes.
You know enough not to tell me because you're afraid I'll talk you out of it.
Absolutely.
So you get over to Peru. It's like 300 hours to get there.
Yes. And then they say, you know, we have a shaman here who wants to read coca leaves for you.
Oh, God, Robin, what are you doing? You're insane.
Howard, I walk into the room where the masters, because they say, okay, now it's time for your ayahuasca ceremony.
Oh, big deal.
And they bring me into this room. There are mats and pillows lining the walls. But there are two buckets in the room. So then the master starts to explain to me. He says, you are going to get sick, but don't worry about it. Everybody does.
Oh.
So the bucket is here for you to vomit in.
Oh, I would have left. I would have just said, you know what? I'm not interested in vomiting.
So finally, after he prays and, you know, he meditates and mm-hmm. he reads the coca leaves, he says, now it's time for you to take la medicina. He tries to open this stuff and it starts foaming. It's like this ugly brown liquid.
Oh, my God. Would you drink out of that?
Look at it. It looks horrible. It is the worst
tasting stuff you could ever imagine. So as soon as you taste it, you don't want to do anything more. And he's right. like, no, drink it up, drink it up, drink it up. So I gulp it down. Oh. And then they sit and watch you.
Right.
Because you got to wait.
You're with these people who don't speak English, and they watch you.
They wait for 20 or 30 minutes to see if something happens.
Did anything happen?
I'm as sick as a dog.
Oh.
And I start throwing up.
Oh, my God.
So
are you insane?
Violently.
You're nuts.
That I'm also farting.
You're nuts. Yeah.
So now I'm embarrassed as anything. And I'm like, maybe I'm retching so loud they can't hear me farting.
Right.
Because it is just like, yes, it sounds like a, you just can't stop. It just keeps going and going and going.
DC's good. Yeah. And what happens to you?
And, you know, somebody's there massaging my shoulders going, it's going to be okay. It's going to be okay. And then when you finally get all of this stuff out of you, you lay back down on this mat and you start to have
visions.
Then I started to see all of the misery of the world.
Oh, wow.
And
that's
Howard,
great.
I cried probably for about 4 hours nonstop.
Oh, my God.
And I mean weeping.
And what's Master doing during this?
Sleeping. Yeah. I could hear him snoring.
It's crazy that you put that into your butt. Wow.
That was only the first night.
What was the second vision? What did you learn?
Well, I learned that life is great except for all the stuff that sucks.
Wow.
And everything that
sucks. You had to go all the way for that?
Is society and expectations and family. All of the crap
is this
we
a new
put
Robin?
On ourselves.
Am I talking to a new Robin?
I am very, very pleasantly surprised that I came home feeling great.
Fred, what do you make of this?
Wow, she won't drink milk.
Right.
But this shit she'll drink.
Right.
It's like fucking turpentine laced with, like, you know.
Well, what she did, you know. It's
bee
like,
shit.
You know, she went and she took drugs
it makes
legally.
Absolutely
yeah.
No sense.
And she's not a drug person.
Right.
And now she's going to base her whole life on this hallucination.
Yeah. You'll see anything if you get high
enough. It's unfucking believable.
Noine.
Boy, you're spending money, man. You went to Ohio, where he was born and raised. And what happened? You bought how many tickets to the Cincinnati Reds game?
It was 4.
Ran you about $1,000, you say.
It's called the Diamond Club. And it's like right behind home plate.
Hey, everybody.
I'm in the Diamond Club.
Hey, where's the Diamond Club? I paid for my buffet.
What did you eat at the buffet?
A thing of fish. I forget what the fish was.
A thing of fish.
Filet
of
fish. Can we please, I'll take one thing of that fish, please. Here at the Diamond Club.
I'll take a hunk of the fish.
Hey, Dad, let me.
A thing of the potatoes.
Dad, let me show you how to order, because I'm pretty sophisticated now. I'll take one thing of potatoes, a thing of fish, and a thing of the prime rib, but just one thing.
What else did he do while he was home besides spend thousands of dollars to see a baseball game?
Yeah.
And a Diamond Club.
Did you stay with your family?
No, we got a hotel.
A hotel.
Meanwhile, didn't he have them all pile in on him when they come to his house?
Oh, yeah. He's sleeping on an air mattress.
Dad, our marital bed is yours.
I told my wife, if there aren't mints on the pillow, I ain't sleeping there.
What did that whole weekend cost you, dude? You had plane tickets, hotel, food. Did you treat the family to dinner every night?
A couple times, yeah.
Put your card away. Your money's no good here.
I mean, this fucking kid, he wants to show up in Cincinnati like he's Rockefeller. Let me handle all the dinners here.
Daddy Warbucks has arrived.
Yeah.
Prime rib for everyone.
Yeah, everyone at the buffet.
Where can we go next? Big vacation.
Why, I got my honeymoon later this year.
Where are you going?
Doing Napa. And,
Napa. What's that going to cost?
Oh, that's expensive.
Well, I mean, no.
Why do you need to go to Napa?
Because that's where I want to go.
Build a nest egg. Listen to me. I'm warning you with peace and love. Courtney in New Hampshire. Hi.
I was listening to the whole thing with JD talking about his honeymoon. Napa is one of the most expensive places to go. I just got back from there. For 6 days, it was probably around $5,000-$6,000.
You hear this, JD? $6,000.
Can you not worry about what the fuck I'm spending my money on? Leave me alone, will you? I'll spend whatever the fuck I want.
What happened between
you,
hey, JD, what happened between the time, like, I was just talking to you and you were normal, now you just, did you get angry after I stopped? You turned into the Incredible Hulk, man.
I'm telling you, where's Bruce Banner? We got to talk to him.
Wow, did you see JD come off like that? You never, ever yelled at me like that before, JD.
I apologize.
No, it's okay. I kind of like it. Turning me on.
I just wish I knew those secret words.
JD Puppet, are you upset too?
My puppet veins are bulging! Rah!